the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. We thank our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ always for allowing us to be in His holy church and sharing His living and life-giving word, which is the truth and nothing but the truth. For those who are with us in this holy church and those who are watching us through live streaming, I pray that you're always in good health and in good spirit in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. If I could ask everyone to stand for the Lord's Prayer, please. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgave our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Psalm number 94. O Lord God, to whom vengeance belongs, O God, to whom vengeance belongs, shine forth, rise up, O judge of the earth, render punishment to the proud. Lord, how long will the wicked triumph? They utter speech and speak insolent things. All the workers of iniquity boast in themselves. They break in pieces your people, O Lord, and afflict your heritage. They slay the widow and the stranger, and murder the fatherless. Yet they say, the Lord does not see, nor does the God of Jacob understand. Understand, you senseless among the people, and you fools, when will you be wise? He who planted the ear, shall he not hear? He who formed the eye, shall he not see? He who instructs the nations, shall he not correct? He who teaches man knowledge, the Lord knows the thoughts of man, that they are futile. Blessed is the man whom you instruct, O Lord, and teach out of your law, that you may give him rest from the days of adversity, until the pit is dug for the wicked. For the Lord will not cast off his people, nor will he forsake his inheritance, but judgment will return to righteousness, and all the upright in heart will follow it. Who will rise up for me against the evildoers? Who will stand up for me against the workers of iniquity? Unless the Lord had been my help, my soul would soon have settled in silence. If I say, my foot slips, your mercy, O Lord, will hold me up. In the multitude of my anxieties within me, your comforts delight my soul. Shall the throne of iniquity, which devises evil by law, have fellowship with you? They gather together against the life of the righteous and condemn innocent blood. But the Lord has been my defense and my God, the rock of my refuge. He has brought on them their own iniquity and shall cut them off in their own wickedness. The Lord our God shall cut them off. And all glory be to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. Well, good evening, everyone. How are we? Are we good? That's the way. That's the way. We thank the Lord. Now, before we start this evening topic, we're going to ask our beloved daughter in Christ, Nora Mushi, to begin this evening with this beautiful and blessed hymn.
Bow down, let us kneel before the Lord our God.
to that. All right, so we are continuing our topic, which is the commentary on the book of Revelation. And today, by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, we'll be completing chapter 14. We'll be reading today from the book of Revelation, chapter 14, verses 17 to 20, which is the end of the chapter. So it is Revelation 14, verses 17 to 20. Then another angel came out of the temple which is in heaven, he also having a sharp sickle. And another angel came out from the altar, who had power over fire, and he cried with a loud cry to him who had the sharp sickle, saying, "Thrust in your sharp sickle and gather the clusters of the vine of the earth, for her grapes are fully ripe." So the angel thrust his sickle into the earth and gathered the vine of the earth and threw it into the great winepress of the wrath of God, and threw it, and the winepress was trampled outside the city, and blood came out of the winepress up to the horses' bridles for 1,600 furlongs or furlongs. And all glory to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ forever and ever.
Amen.
Can't hear you.
Amen.
Can't hear you.
Amen.
That's the way. Okay. Last time, we spoke about there was this who was like the Son of Man sitting on the cloud with a crown of gold on his head, and he had a sharp sickle in his hand. This angel came out of the temple and said to the one who was sitting on the cloud, thrust in your sickle, cast it down, and reap the land, for it is ripe. The earth is ripe now, reap it all. And he thrust it in his sickle and reaped the whole earth. We said the one who was sitting on the cloud, who was like the Son of Man, is no one but Jesus Christ of Nazareth. All glory to his holy and mighty name. The sickle, he did not come himself and reaped the earth, he cast it down. Meaning the sickle here represents nations. The Lord will use certain superpowers of the world as that sickle that reaps the wheat field. Those nations will be used by the Lord himself to bring destruction upon the whole world, which has rejected till the very last minute Jesus Christ of Nazareth. So now we're continuing this topic. And by the way, chapter 14 is more so focused on the Israelite nation, the Jewish people of the end times, the 21st century. And we started in recent days and weeks, we started noticing things happening in Israel that haven't happened for a little while. Every nation will go against Christ before his second coming. This is the very clear and concise sign. If anybody says, when is the Lord coming back? When you see the whole world going against the Lord Jesus, rest assured, the end is very near. The end is very near. So now we read in verse 17. Then another angel came out of the temple, which is in heaven, he also having a sharp sickle. We said last time the temple here is talking about Israel, because who are the people of the temple? The Israelite nation. We are the people of the church, not the temple. The New Testament church is to do with the church, but the temple is to do with Israel, i.e. the Jewish people of the end times. So another angel came out of the temple, which is in heaven, he also having a sharp sickle. Just like the Lord Jesus had the sharp sickle, so as this angel who came out of the temple, the second angel, has having also a sharp sickle like the Lord. And then verse 18, and another angel came out from the altar. And the altar is in the temple. Now, if you're not aware, why are the Israelis and the Palestinians always in conflict? They're not in conflict because of gold, diamonds, and whatever it is. No, they're in conflict because of Mount Moriah, the Temple Mount. Now, currently, our beloved Muslims, they have their second holiest place built on the Temple Mount, Mount Moriah, in the heart of the old Jerusalem, the Dome of the Rock and Masjid Al-Aqsa. So this is to them out of bounds, out of limit. No one touches that place. You touch that place, we blow you up, we kill you. The Israelite people, they want that Mount Moriah, the Temple Mount, because to them they believe that's where the Temple of King Solomon was once upon a time erected upon that mountain or that hill. So one of the signs of the end times, the temple will be rebuilt. That has to happen. That has to happen. The temple has to be rebuilt. So now there is a problem. There's a lot of conflict in there. Anyway, it's not our topic now as yet. So now the Jewish people, those who are Orthodox Jews, they have been crying to their Yahweh on that wailing wall. Have you seen them where they go and pray and cry and they shed tears at the wailing wall? Now that wailing wall, they claim that this was the one part of the boundary of that temple which King Solomon built. That's the remains of that fence or wall of the boundary line of the temple. So they go to the wailing wall begging God, the God of Israel, Yahweh, to build them the temple once again. Why? Because they wish to offer sacrifices as animals for the remission of sin. Now they cannot offer any animals as a sacrifice to God for the forgiveness of sin, as their forefathers used to do in the olden days, in the Old Testament era, because the only way they can offer those animals as a sacrifice for forgiveness of sins, they need to have a temple in order to have an altar. They cannot offer an animal as a sacrifice without an altar. And they cannot have an altar without a temple. What do they have now? And for so many centuries, synagogues. That's all they have. A synagogue is a place where they gather, they pray and talk whatever scripture or, you know, they talk about. So the synagogue is a place of gathering and praying. They cannot offer sacrifices in a synagogue. It has to be a temple, because only in the temple altar can be erected. And to have the altar, then and then only they can bring an animal, slain it, offer it on that altar, and ask Yahweh to forgive their sins and the people's sins. So this angel came out of the altar, another one. Now the one that came out of the altar, it says in verse 18, who had power over fire. So the one who came out of the altar had power over fire. The one who came out of the temple had a very sharp sickle in his hand. But the one who came out of the altar had power over fire, and he cried with a loud cry to him who had the sharp sickle who came out of the temple in verse 17. So the one who came out of the altar cried out to the one who came out of the temple with the sharp sickle, saying, Thrust in your sharp sickle and gather the clusters of the vine of the earth, for her grapes are fully ripe. Different language. Now the one who looked like the Son of Man sitting on the cloud, who had a sharp sickle, he thrust it in onto the earth. For the earth was ripe, he said, reap it. But now, this angel who came out of the altar said to the one who came out of the temple, thrust in your sharp sickle, for the grapes, the clusters, for the grapes are ripe now. Her grapes. Wow, he's talking in a feminine way. Her grapes are ripe. The clusters of the vine of the earth, and gather the clusters of the vine of the earth, for her grapes are fully ripe. So the angel thrust his sickle into the earth and gathered the vine of the earth and threw it into the great wine press of the wrath of God. Do you have time? Good. So how are we? Okay, are you okay? So let's speak in a simple language. Okay, don't look at the screen. Look at this good-looking bishop, man. My name is Bishop Murray. I'm single and available. I'm hot, you're not. Thank you very much. All right, here we go. This angel that came out of the temple had a sharp sickle. Another one came out of the altar who had power over fire, said to the one who came out of the temple, thrust in your sickle because the clusters of the earth, the grapes are ripe. You need to gather the clusters, for her grapes are fully ripe. Please pay attention. This is focused on the Israelite nation in the 21st century. However, I'm talking about the Great Tribulation. The Great Tribulation is focused on the Israelite nation in the 21st century. However, the Great Tribulation will cover the whole globe. Everyone will be affected by it. Christians, non-Christians, every human being that will remain and go through the Great Tribulation will be affected by it, because it entails World War III nuclear weapons. So now, I'm not scaring you. Be strong. You have Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Who cares? I wish I died tomorrow. I died today, I wish. I want to go to my sweetheart. What am I doing in this sick world? I want to go and be with my sweetheart. I can't wait. So nothing worries me. And so should you, if you truly believe in the Lord. So now, the Lord Jesus is the good shepherd to two branches of his beloved church. He is the good shepherd of the Old Testament church, and he is the good shepherd to his New Testament church. Now, the Old Testament church is resembled by the vine tree. The New Testament church is resembled by the bride of the groom. So we are the bride. The Old Testament church, the Israelite people, are the vine tree, not the bride. They are the vine tree. Now, the Lord came in his first coming to the Old Testament church first, the vine tree. The Old Testament church, at the end of chapter 12 of the Gospel according to Saint Matthew, they called Jesus the head of Satan. He is Baal-Zebub. He is Satan. They called him Satan. So they said, we don't want you. They rejected Christ on his first coming. He turned his face to the pagan world to establish his church in the New Testament. And he started his ministry in chapter 13 by getting into the boat at the shores of the Sea of Galilee. Now the boat is the establishment of the church in the New Testament. because we are resembled by the ocean, Israelites are resembled by the land. So he entered the boat in the sea, water. Who are the waters? Us, pagans, worshippers of idols, false gods. There was only one nation that worshiped the true divine God. When the true divine God came to them, they crucified him. So this God turned his way to the pagan world to gather as many people as possible from the world and bring them into the New Testament church, which is us. How long has the Good Shepherd been doing this, gathering people of the world? 2023 years. It's a bit funny. You know, when the Lord gathered his disciples and he took them to Mount Olive, the Mount of Olives, he went up to the top of the mountain, and then from the Mount of Olives he ascended to heaven. He said to his disciples, I'm going to prepare a place for you and I'm coming back soon. So they waited. See, when God speaks, you will never fully fathom what he is really meaning and saying. To their minute intellectual capacity, they sort of put it in their head and came to this conclusion. Oh, well, he's going up, he's gonna come back another, what, half an hour, 1 hour, 2 hours, we'll wait. There is no going downtown, so we're gonna wait. So they waited as the Lord is going up, and then the clouds covered him and he disappeared. Then angels came down and said, you Galileans, what are you doing here? Oh, they said, well, our Lord Jesus said, I'm going up to prepare a place for you guys and I'm coming back shortly. So we're waiting for him to come back and take us to the place. The angels looked, they didn't laugh, but they said, go home. All right, it's been now 2023 years. Imagine what would have happened to their necks. Look it up for 2023 years. For a day is like 1,000 years to God, and 1,000 years is like a day. So the Lord came to the New Testament. He gathered people from the world, and he's still gathering. Why? Because a time is coming. The door will be closed in the face of the New Testament church. There will be maybe still churches around. You'll go and pray, no more Jesus hearing you. He will say, I don't know who you are. Why? Because he needs to fulfill the promise which he gave to our father Abraham, who is the father of the Old Testament church. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. These are the fathers of the Old Testament. He gave a promise to Abraham, I will visit your son. By my son, I will visit your children in the end of times. So on his second return, what will the Lord do? The door in our face will be shut in order to be open to the Jewish people. He needs to bring them back. So how is he going to bring them back in the end of times? Through the great tribulation. Through the great tribulation. So now, they're dying to build the temple on Mount Moriah. But that's the second holiest place to the Muslim world. In order to build the temple, you need to bring everything down. The Dome of the Rock, Masjid al-Aqsa, and build the temple. You're asking for a lot of trouble. Therefore, another superpower will come up and will make this possible for the Jews. Not America, another superpower. America won't do that. It's not for them to do it, someone else. Now, the one who came out of the altar had power over fire. But the one who came out of the temple had the sharp sickle. And then the one from the altar said to the one from the temple, please thrust in your sickle and gather the clusters for the grapes, for her grapes are fully ripe. Now he uses John the Beloved here by the power of the Holy Spirit and inspiration. He uses her grapes. Now the word her can only apply to the church because the church is the woman and Christ is the man. You see, man and woman. No man and man, no woman and woman, naughty boys and girls, get alive. For her grapes are fully ripe. Now her is a female, feminine. The church is the female, the woman, for the Christ is the man. Now her grapes, why her grapes? Because the Old Testament church is represented or resembled by the vine tree. Now her grapes are fully ripe. In verse 19, so the angel thrust his sickle into the earth and gathered the vine of the earth and threw it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. This winepress is the wrath of God. You see, in the first coming of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, he says, I have gone through the winepress on my own. This is in the book of Isaiah. I have passed through the winepress on my own, meaning Jesus was pressed on the cross, for he is the grape that was crushed on the cross. And when that grape was crushed, blood came out, red color comes out of the grape. His blood gushed out of his body. He is that grape that got crushed on the cross, and his blood was shed on Calvary on the cross to save and redeem everyone who receives him as Lord and Savior. But this wine press is the wrath of God. This wine press, which is the cross, is the mercy of God. Do you see? So there is the wine press of the wrath of God, and there is the wine press of the mercy of God. Jesus crushed on the cross is the wine press of the mercy of God, but in the end times it will be the wine press of the vengeance and the wrath of God. No more mercy. Last week, the one who looked like the Son of Man, who sat on the cloud, thrust in his sickle and reaped the earth. The Lord is coming soon to close the door in the face of the New Testament church, us, to open the door to the Old Testament church of the end times, the Israelite, the Jewish people. When he closes the door here, he'll open it in their face. He will open the door in their face. A lot of them will come back, but those who refuse, they will go through the wine press of the wrath of God. How is the Lord Jesus going to bring the Jewish people of the 21st century back to him? Through the sickle that was in his hand and he thrust it in. What is the sickle? Nations. The Lord is in charge of all the kings of the earth. Meaning, who appoints prime ministers? Who appoints prime ministers? The Lord. Who appoints presidents? The Lord. Who appoints kings on earth? The Lord. No one else. They can manipulate the voting system. They can play with the numbers and put Biden instead of Trump. but it is the Lord who is in charge at the end. And if you believe in this, you will see the glory of God in your life, my dear friend. For no secret societies can put anyone in power unless Jesus says so. This is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help you, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, for he is the only true God revealed in the flesh. And I've said this before, and I'll say it again. The reason why Biden won the election which was rigged, 100% it was rigged by the secret societies. Why did the Lord allow it? I want America to hear this. The people of America, which I love, and I pray for. The Lord allowed Biden to be your president to send a very powerful message to all of you, our beloved people of America. The Lord is saying, just like Biden forgets his name, you, my people, have forgotten my name. I, the Lord. America, in recent years, they've drifted so far and away from Christ. It is not a joke. America is on the verge of collapse, but Trump will win 2024 election. No matter who tries to stop it, Trump will win it. Jesus is bringing Trump back because he still has time with the world. He wants to bring more people of the world because the door will be closed soon. And he wants to refurbish his church because his church has gone so far away from him. The church has lost a plot. Church leaders are not working for Christ, they are working for Satan. Church leaders literally denying their master, bowing before Satan, allowing evilness to infiltrate and shape the church which Christ himself built on the rock with his own precious blood. Shame on us. Judas Iscariot is much better than all of us put together. Because Judas Iscariot was a man. He'd never denied Jesus Christ. He went to the Jewish priests and he said, listen guys, this is the Messiah. I believe and I know this. I will hand you over the Messiah. Grab him and kill him. Because he thought for himself, Messiah is prophesied about, he cannot die. So I'm gonna let him face death. This is the only way the Messiah will start acting. I've been talking to him for the last 3 years, saying, Lord, we've been a punching bag to the Egyptians, to the Romans. Enough of slavery. Give us kingdom, give us our freedom, give us our kingdom on earth. He said, if someone slaps you on this cheek, give him the other. If someone drags you by force a mile, go with him another one. Enough slapping, enough being enslaved. You, nothing was working with you, Jesus, until I'm gonna sell you with 30 pieces of silver and I'll make you face death. When you face death, since the Messiah cannot die, you will have no other choice but to wipe the Roman Empire from the face of this world. That's why he went and gave Jesus to the Jews, because he wanted the Messiah to act. He did it purposely, believing this is the Messiah. Today, we are not as a man like Judas. We're not men. Judah was a man. Church leaders today are cowards. Cowards selling their master. Selling their master to have their own pleasures. red belt in karate. So my beloveds, the Lord will use certain nations to discipline the Jews. The Lord will use certain nations to discipline the Jews. The Great Tribulation is where this superpower will flip on the Israelite people, where they will have a treaty with this superpower and they'll become very good friends, but afterwards the superpower will be against the Israelite people and will decimate them. Her grapes are fully ripe. The Old Testament is the vineyard, is the vine tree. I want to read you. Actually, I'll come back to it. So what will happen? Thrust in your sickle and gather the clusters for her grapes, her, the church of the Old Testament, which is the vine tree. Her grapes are fully ripe. The first time the Lord will discipline the Jews using a superpower nation. When that superpower nation overcomes the Israelite people and conquer the world, that superpower will come back and say, I am God on earth. You know, when you succeed in something, you become kind of boastful about it. Oh, look at me, what I've done. Look at me, what I've achieved. Look at me, what I've built. Look at me, what I've conquered. You know, when you achieve something at a very big, large magnitude, all of a sudden you become so much of a show-off, you lose track that you are nothing but a minute piece of dust. So that superpower, after overcoming the Israelite people and conquering the whole world, they will come back and say, we are God on earth. God will teach him a lesson and send an angel from the altar who has the power over fire and decimate the superpower. Just like he did in the Old Testament with certain people, he will do it in the end times. He is the same God. The Israelite people of the Old Testament, every time they walked away from God, God brought a nation, striked the Israelite people, disciplined them, taught them a lesson they never forgot. When they were actually disciplined by that nation, they woke up and repented to God and said, please God, have mercy on us. When they came back, God struck that superpower or that nation which he used. Because that superpower in the end times is a pagan one. It's a beast, godless. More than likely, it is the Chinese regime supported by Russia. More than likely. There are some amazing Chinese people. Man, I love you. You're so cute. Huh? Ni hao, ho ho. Man, I love you. Till now, I'm trying to learn how to eat with those two chopsticks. But I'll grasp it one day. There are some wonderful Chinese people, but the regime is godless. Godless. Their symbol is a dragon. What is the dragon in the Holy Bible? Satan, isn't it? And they go and play the dragon in the streets. Dum, 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 dum. China has now a stronghold in the Middle East. So has Russia. See, they go together. I don't want to give you too much information, right? Yeah, you probably already know. Maybe you know more than me. I don't know. Probably you do. China and Russia will always be together. Russia is the brain of China. Russia is the military power of China. They are the one who give them all the technology, weaponry. It's the Russian people are with the brains. What happened in Lebanon was a deliberate act where they blew that port. That wasn't just something that it was stored for about 6-7 years, and all of a sudden with some friction and miraculously poof. No, that was a bomb very close. The way it formed that onion thing in the air, it exactly like a nuclear bomb going off. But it was not a nuclear, but it was a very powerful bomb. They blew that port deliberately. Russia is in Syria. America wants to be in Lebanon. And poor innocent people being killed for the politics of sick in the head so-called governments. Sick in the head. What kind of a sickness is this that you want to conquer the world? Okay, you've conquered the world, and then what? That's sick. You'll never be content. It's like a little kid. The first time you buy him a little toy, they're content. After a little while, they get fed up. I want a bicycle, and then I want a motorcycle, and then I want a car, and then I want a plane, and then I don't want nothing. I'm bored. Well, go and kill yourself. I don't know. It's a sick world. Sick world, my beloved, sick. The end is the grave. What conquer? You conquer nothing because you have nothing. It is God, Jesus Christ, who gave you everything and made you someone special. Without Christ, all of us are nothing. So they have a big stronghold in Syria, the Russians. And yes, America wants to have a stronghold in Lebanon. It's strategic. They have a massive port right on the Mediterranean Sea. If they want to bring ships and things and trades and everything, it's nice and easy. You see, the world is preparing itself for the finale stage, because my beloved, the great tribulation is focused on the Israelite people. Where? Israel, Middle East. Anybody home? World War III will begin from the Middle East, not here, not in Fairfield. It's going to be in the Middle East and Israel. There will be nations coming to really give Israel a hard time. And then, after they strike Israel, that superpower will say, I am God. The Lord will send them an angel out of the altar who has power over fire. He will burn that superpower before they blink their eyes. Amen. If Jesus wants to be angry, don't stay here. I can assure you this. Or if he turns the other cheek, run for your life. But you can't run from the Lord. He will get you. He will get you no matter where you are or who you are. He's your creator. Who are you trying to escape? The Israelite nation, till this moment, have sought a kingdom on earth. And to their way of thinking, the way we can conquer earth, money, Habibi. Honey, 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 make me money in this big wide world. Money talks. Money gives you power. Power gives you control. Give you control. The Israelite people, unfortunately, ever since rejected Jesus Christ of Nazareth, they have put their hope on people, not on God. They may say, we pray to God, we pray to Yahweh, we pray to Elohim, to the one and only. You can say that, my dear friend, but you're putting your hope in men, not in God. And that man is a dead corpus like everyone else. Don't put your hope in men. When Great Britain was in its glory, they went and held on to Great Britain, lest Great Britain give them Israel as a country. And that was the Balfour Treaty in 1918. That Balfour Treaty said Israel is a recognized nation. And in 1948, they went in to Israel and landed at Tel Aviv Airport. 600,000 people landed in Tel Aviv Airport. Since 70 AD, they came back home in 1948. And in 1967, that Six-Day War, Israel now is a recognized country in the UN. Who is the UN? America. When Great Britain went, United States became the superpower. The Jews went and said, we're American now. So they held on to America. America, you defend us. America, you give us this. America, we want everything. America, give us the temple. America won't do that. You see, because neither America nor anyone is in control, Jesus is. Israel, you need to come back to Jesus. And until you do that, no one will come to your rescue. No one will give you nothing, because only God can. Not men. Not a superpower. America will go. Pray that 2024 election is the decisive election for America to stay or to be gone once and for all. Has America done a lot of naughty things and bad things? Absolutely yes. But remember this, the day America goes, Christians are also gone. That's another sign. It's not that America is protecting the Christians. No, 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 no. But that's a sign from the Lord. Trump will win 2024 100%. Because the Lord still has little time left for the world to be delivered from eternal death, eternal hell, and to be with Satan. Jesus Christ is still winning souls from the world. Satan is trying to put an end. Open your eyes, my beloveds, young men and women. Don't just be so blind and so naive and say, all I want to do is just have fun. I want to go out and party. I want to go to the club, to the pub, to Star City Casino. I want to fly. I want to go on holidays. I want to go to restaurants. I want to dance with somebody. I want to drink. I want to change my looks, blow up my cheeks, my lips. Enough. I beg you, enough. No time. Jesus is coming back. The world will be engulfed with fire. God covered the world first with water. In the end, he will cover it with fire. He'll burn it. because of the sin of mankind, humanity has gone totally evil. Evil. Even in the church. I beg you, I'm not saying don't go out at all, but I am saying one thing, please hear me out. I'm saying whatever you do, let Jesus be with you. Let the Lord be with you. Don't walk away. Don't fall for the temptations of the world, and all you care about is you. How you look, how you dress, what you eat, what you drink, and how you travel, in what kind of a car and a house you live and drive. Enough of materialism. Wake up, wake up, wake up, for the time is at hand. We need to come back and kneel before the Lord, praying, begging Him for mercy, begging Him for forgiveness, begging Him for His loving kindness, for the time is near. The time is near. And I can assure you, it's not me talking. This is not me. I leave the church, I'm someone else. Because I know myself. This is not me. Don't ever come to church and say the bishop was preaching. No, it was the Lord talking through this useless, hopeless piece of wreck called Bishop Murray. I'm nothing but a sinner. I am a nothing. It is the Lord. It is the Lord. His name is Jesus Christ. I'm licking the dust that is stuck at the foot of His sandals, because this is cleansing me now. It's cleansing me. Jesus is amazing. Every time I feel so down and so at the edge, my sweetheart comes. Every time without fail, my sweetheart comes. What party? What King's Cross? What Star City Casino? What clubbing? What white powder? Step on it. Step on it. We need to be close to the Lord and His holy church. We need to be close. Pray for the church leaders, all of us, to really have that courage to stand for the Lord. Not be weak. Not be cowards. Not be traitors selling their master. You're selling him for what? For some worldly glory, which is like a dream at the awakening. What are you going to do, my dear friend, when your spirit is called back to Christ and you're going to face your judge? What are you going to do? I can assure you, my dear friend, neither your authority nor your rank nor anything that you had on earth is going to come to your rescue. The only thing that comes to my and your rescue is the blood of the Lamb of God that was shed on Calvary. That's the only thing. You go there, you say, Lord, and by the blood which you shed on Calvary, have mercy on me, I the sinner. It is then and then only Christ will have mercy on you. His blood. He paid the price, and what a price He paid. His life, He gave it up for me and you. Oh, I don't want to keep you here for too long, even though I'm tempted. Pray, my dear, pray. Throw it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. Gather the clusters of the vine of the earth, for her grapes are fully ripe, the Israelite nation, church of the end times. So that angel thrusted his sickle and he gathered all those grapes, but he threw them in the winepress of the wrath of God. Verse 20. And the winepress was trampled outside the city. I want to read something actually before I go into that, if I may. It's not on the screen, so actually it's here. It's not on the screen. This is in the book of Isaiah, chapter 5, verses 1 to 7. Isaiah 5, verses 1 to 7. It is the Lord God speaking through Isaiah about his church of the Old Testament, which is the vine tree. Look what he's saying, the Lord. Now let me sing to my well-beloved a song of my beloved regarding his vineyard. My well-beloved has a vineyard. Who is talking here? God the Father. Who is the beloved of the Father? The one and only, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. So God the Father is talking about his beloved Son. He says, my beloved Son has a vineyard because my Son is the Good Shepherd. And this Good Shepherd is the Good Shepherd for two branches, Old and New Testament. The Old Testament is the vineyard. He says, my well-beloved has a vineyard on a very fruitful hill. So he planted, the Son planted the vineyard on a fruitful hill. The ground is fertile, the ground is lush, the ground is rich. He dug it up. Who dug it up? The Son. He dug it up and cleared out its stones and planted it with the choicest vine, the best of the best. He built a tower in its midst and also made a wine press in it. So he expected it to bring forth good grapes, but it brought forth wild grapes. Can't do nothing with it. He came, they said, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. His blood is on us and on our children. Only a fool would say such a statement. Do you think it's easy to take the blood of Christ on you and on your children? You are still paying for it till this very day, my beloved Israel. Do you have rest? No. Do you have peace? No. Can America give you peace? No. Did Great Britain give you peace? No. Can any power give you peace? No. You have the money of the world, you Freemason. Can you give peace to you and your family? No. You still live in hiding. Your names are not registered anywhere because you don't want anyone to know that you exist. But God sees you, my dear friend. Sees you. Because peace only the beloved of the Father can give. His name is Jesus. Yeshua, isn't it? Shalom. Yeshua. Mashiach. Attu malkat yudaya. You know, the Passion of the Christ. I was actually listening to them because they were talking in Aramaic. But because they were European actors, they couldn't pronounce the words. They had, you see, Aramaic is very difficult. It's all chechu, chachu, chichu. So it's very difficult for a European, a non-Aramaic speaking person to say it. So I was listening to them. I couldn't gather what they were saying. But I looked at the subtitles. I said, oh my goodness. I'm going to call Mel Gibson. I say, please, next time you want to do another movie, please let me come and help you with it. and teach them to pronounce it correctly. Mashiach. Well, I'm still offering my services, dear Mel Gibson. I live in Fairfield, in Sydney, Australia. So if you need my help, dear Mel Gibson, please let me know. I will come and I'll help you with whatever projects you have as far as doing it in the name of the Lord Jesus, for he's the only one. The only one. So Mel Gibson, you can call me. But it brought forth wild grapes, and now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge, please, between me and my vineyard. What more could I have done to my vineyard that I have not done in it? I've done everything to my vineyard. I came to you. I gave you my life. I begged you. Let me heal you. Let me cleanse you. I begged you. I did everything in my power to bring you to me. What else could I have done? Why then, when I expected it to bring forth good grapes, did it bring forth wild grapes? And now, please let me tell you. Oh, look at this, man. You see, when the Lord gives a chance, oh yeah, he is extremely patient. But when he runs out of patience, he will say, now you listen to me. Before, please listen to me. Please, I beg you. Please come back. Please, please, please. Once that is gone, he'll say, you, come here. Now you're going to listen whether you like it or not, because I'm going to break you. And you can't do nothing. You cannot do anything about it. I'm breaking you. Wow. Listen to this. And now, please let me tell you what I will do to my vineyard. What I will do. Not think about it, I will do. I will take away its hedge. Hedge, defense. I will take away the hedge. No more protection. No more protection, Israel. Oh, he's going to remove his protection. They think America's protecting them. It's the Lord. Wake up. It's the Lord Jesus. He still loves you. He still loves you. He made a promise to Abraham, our father. He can't go back on his promise. I will take away its hedge. Isaiah chapter 5 is the 21st century. Also, the second coming, not just the first, but the second as well. I will take away its hedge. What's going to happen, Lord, when you do that? And it shall be burned. Wow. Caesar burned Jerusalem. He torched it with the people of Jerusalem. He hanged them on a stick. And he torched them. And break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will lay it waste. And it was in 70 AD. And it will be in the end of times. It shall not be pruned or dug, but there shall come up briars and thorns. Condemnation is coming. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain on it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah are his pleasant plant. He looked for justice, but behold, oppression. For righteousness, but behold, a cry for help. They rejected the Lord. He will take them through the vineyard, through the wine press of the wrath of God, and will decimate. Then they will see who Jesus Christ is. He's been crying out for thousands of years. For thousands of years. But a lot of Jewish will come back to the Lord. But those who refuse, they'll be gone forever. Forever they will be gone. Now, and the winepress was trampled outside the city, and blood came out of the winepress up to the horses' bridles. for 1,600 furlongs. And the language of prophecy and symbolism. And the winepress was trampled outside the city. The winepress was trampled outside the city. When Jesus Christ came, what did they do? They looked at him and they said, "He is the inheritor. Let's take him outside the city and crucify him. What goes around comes around. You took me outside the city and trampled me on the cross. I will come in the second coming. I'll take you outside the city and you'll be trampled underfoot if you don't repent." The blood came out of the wine press up to the horse's bridles, up to the horse's mouth. Now the horse is kind of tall to the mouth, like it's a pool, a flood of blood. For 1,600 furlongs. 1,600 furlongs is almost 322 kilometers. Imagine 322 kilometers with blood up to the horse's mouth for a distance of 322 kilometers. Now this is symbolic. It is literally saying that the Middle East, there will be a bloodshed to the horse's mouth the world hasn't seen yet. Because the judgment or the winepress of the wrath of God, when God gets angry, it's not easy. Oh, it's not easy. Oh, he judges. Oh, he is the only judge, and he is awesome and mighty. He's awesome and mighty. The superpower that will strike Israel is already in the Middle East. The Middle East, that's where World War III will start. There will be a great, massive bloodshed the world hadn't seen yet. Hadn't seen yet. The Holocaust of that sick man Hitler. Oh, by the way, he was a Freemason. That Holocaust is like a walk in the park. Nothing compares to what's going to happen in this century. Nothing. When China takes over, they won't be Mr. Nice Guy Ni Hao anymore. They will kill everyone that stands in their way. They will slain everyone and enslave those who remain living. America is still saying to China, "Don't move. I kill you." The Lord is in control. Not George Soros and the likes of him. I feel sorry for him. His 1 week is up. I haven't forgotten. I say this to the people of America. In 2024, make sure Trump wins. And if they're going to try to falsify it, they're going to try everything under the sun. If they bring someone else, you go and grab that someone else from the White House and pull him out and throw him out in the street. Only Trump needs to go there, no one else. Only Trump needs to go there, no one else. If anyone else comes in 2024 outside of Trump, you can kiss America goodbye. And World War III will begin shortly thereafter. So don't worry about changing your facial looks. The nuclear warhead will take care of that for free. Boom, gone. No face. I will have no face anymore. What's your name? No name. There was a product in Franklin's called No Name, long time ago. I don't know if it's still around or not. There will be a great deal of bloodshed in the Middle East. The war in the 1980 between Iraq and Iran was orchestrated by the Western political agendas, evil agendas. World War I, World War II, all orchestrated. To do one thing, certain sick people in the head want to be God on earth. I think this is the funniest joke I ever came across with. You know, it's the funniest joke. You want to conquer the world? Satan has really played with you like a little toy. By the way, this is Satan all behind this, huh? This ugly little thing. He tried to pay me a visit the other day. Look, my beloveds. We have our youth ministry just started, 18 plus. I encourage you to be part of it. Especially for young men and women that are listening, watching us through live streaming, and all of you who are in this church. Enroll, put your name down. After we finish, see one of the youth group committee members and write your name down. It's 18 plus. Join the youth ministry. Let's be together. Let's build ourselves by the grace of God on the rock who is Christ Jesus. Be close. Be close to the Lord. Be close to the Lord. I encourage you to be part of this youth ministry. All the young men and women, 18 plus. I beg you. Next time you want to go out, I'll come with you. Take me with you, please. Imagine, like in this outfit, I'm walking in the city at 10 p.m. Hello, Habibi. and then you go and take me. You go take me to your clubbing place. How can you be in those places, man? Don't drink tequila. No good for you. Come and drink the blood of the Lamb of God. This is the only medicine for you. And for all of us, for every human being, Jesus Christ is the only way. Look, I'll say this, and I won't be repeating it that often. I've been to both sides, heaven and hell. All glory to Jesus Christ of Nazareth. All glory to his name, holy name. I've been to heaven and I've been to hell. I've sat with Jesus and I've sat with Satan. All by the will of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I can assure you, you cannot last one split second with Satan. Please don't sell Jesus for a drink, for a white powder, for gambling, for womanizing, boys and girls, girls and boys, having fun in the hotel, in the streets, in the dark alleys. Please, please, don't sell your Lord. Please, I beg you, don't. You can't afford to lose Jesus, I can assure you. I'm saying it out of love, out of love, out of love. I'm crying out to everyone, to all of us. We cannot afford to lose Jesus Christ, believe you me. Not because he can give me everything, which he can, but we can't afford to lose him because you'll never come across anyone this beautiful, this awesome, this tender, this kind, this loving, this mighty, absolute gem of a man, the man and the God. You can't afford to lose him. You will never find anyone anywhere near who he is and what he is. He is simply irresistible, irreplaceable. This is why I'm begging you, we cannot afford to lose him. He is too good to be true, yet he is the truth. Don't. Next time your friend says, let's go and do this, say no. And if they ask you why, say the Lord won't be happy. So what do you want to do then? I'm going to see the good-looking bishop in the church, and I encourage you to come with me, because I'm not gonna go downtown anymore. I'm going uptown. We need the Lord. We need the Lord, I beg of you. Don't lose the Lord ever. I know I've gone over my limit, but I just can't help it sometimes, or a lot of times. One day I spoke for an hour, I jinxed myself. Sooner or later, every human being, I'm not talking Christians now, human being, everyone will know it's only Jesus. I was praying to this prophet, I was praying to this nice person, turned out to be a nothing. Believe me, I'm talking with love and respect. I've been there. I didn't see Muhammad, I didn't see Buddha, I didn't see Krishna, I didn't see no one. I saw the sweetheart of all sweethearts, the light of the world. This has got nothing to do whether you are a Christian or not. This has got to do with the truth. This has got to do with God. Who is this God that created everyone and everything, visible and invisible? Jesus. The love of my life. His name is Jesus. It's Jesus, my beloved. That's who you're going to see when you go there. By His grace and His precious blood, when you enter paradise, it's Jesus. Oh, He's stunning. But He took me somewhere else, not just paradise. With Satan, oh, I would never wish the worst enemy of all enemies to be with Satan for a second. I will pray everyone to be delivered from the hands of Satan. Terrible. He is terrible, 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 ugly, poison. Hatred is his entire being. He hates with a passion. Very ugly to be with him. Very ugly to be with him. The Lord kept me in that situation for a while. I can assure you, you can't talk unless the Lord gives you the permission. Someone like me can't talk. He will shut me up. Believe me, He will shut me up. So, He's allowing it. So, boys and girls, are you ready?
Yes.
We're going to go together.
Yes.
And we're going to have fun together. Yes? Yes? It's just a Stunning young man sitting at the front row here. And his name is Sharvel. So beautiful. join the youth ministry. That's all I'm going to say. God bless you. We need to pray for everyone. We need to pray for our beloved Middle East. We need to pray for our beloved people of Israel, for they to realize that Jesus Christ is the only way, the only truth, and the only life. And for every Christian and every non-Christian, we pray alike for everyone to come to this realization, because so many Christians have no idea who Christ is. They're just Christians by name, but have no idea who Jesus Christ is. We need to come back and live the Lord, not just be named after Him or talk about Him, or I'm just called a Christian, but don't ask me anything about Christianity because I have no idea. No, we need to come back and live the Lord. Live Him, for He is the truth. He is the real person. Stunning, 6 foot one. Long tan skin, browny, crispy hair, split in the middle, all the way to the shoulders. His beard is not as long as mine, shorter, still black because he's still 33 and kicking baby. Still young. And he's got beautiful greenish, I don't know how to describe him, beautiful eyes. He's got a beautiful smile. Oh, when he smiles. Melts you. One day you will face Him. You'll forget yourself because of His beauty. Don't cry if Rachel leaves you. Cry if Jesus leaves you. Because you can get another Rachel, Habibi. I'll find you one, don't worry. And don't cry when Romeo leaves you. Say, hallelujah, thank God, I am finished with this stubborn Romeo. He was nothing but a pain in my life. Now I am free because I have my Jesus. God bless you. Here we go. I'm running out of jokes. I need some more jokes, please. So send them my way. Email us with your jokes, but I want them to be, what's those things? PG. I was going to say GP. Thank you so much. Make them PG rated. Nothing 15 plus or 18 plus. Please keep them outside of your life. PG. A PG joke, right? Why was the jockey sniffing his nose all the time? Because his nose was running. I hear this from 6-year-old, 7-year-old kids. Why did they bury a salesperson under the house? Because it was a good place for a seller. Why couldn't the skeleton jump off the bridge? Because he didn't have the guts. Why is this bishop good looking? Because I'm natural. Never been to Istanbul. No plastic surgery so far. I'm nature, natural. All right, we're going to ask our beloved Nora before she goes to sleep to sing another hymn. Let us contemplate and listen to these beautiful lyrics. Thank you.
again. I don't need to keep on hiding. I'm fully known and loved by you. You won't let go home, no matter what I do. And it's not one or the other. It's hard truth and ridiculous grace to be known.
Okay, just very briefly, a couple of announcements. We have one of our beautiful initiatives called Feeding Hearts, where we go once a fortnight to Martin Place, Sydney, and being with our beloved, the homeless people. I call them the brothers of Christ. So we go once a fortnight. I believe we have the person who is looking after the committee here, because they do need your help. If anyone here can help in any way, form or shape, please see Janet Georges in the foyer. Janet Georges, and she will explain what they need as far as assistance. We can organize small groups once a fortnight if you'd like to go with us to the city and be there to give all the foods and the beverages. We have a lot of beautiful, you know, homeless people there. They love the Assyrian food. One guy was saying, I like the dolma. Now, the dolma is a very typical Middle Eastern and Assyrian food. So they prefer the dolma over the maccas, mate, yeah, and the prawns on the barbie. So, yeah, we are gradually converting them into the Middle Eastern beautiful patisseries. So Feeding Hearts, Janet Georges will be waiting there. If you could help in any way, form or shape, please do see her. And yeah, that would be greatly, greatly appreciated. Teens for Christ, from the ages of 12 to 19. Father George, he is one of the priests parish here, is organizing a spiritual camp. So mom and dads, you have teenagers from the ages of 12 to 19, please let them know, enroll their names for this spiritual camp. It'll take place in July. It will be from Friday the 14th of July to Sunday the 16th of July. It's for a couple of days, a spiritual retreat. I encourage mom and dad to enroll your teenagers, boys and girls, both. And please do see Father George more information in regards to this spiritual camp. Please keep in your prayers this intention of building or having a primary school and a high school here for our church. So please do pray for this intention for the primary and the high school. The last thing is the church also provides NDIS services. So if you know any people that are in need of NDIS services, the church is the NDIS provider. So we do provide these services. Please do speak to people that you know of and let us know to reach out to them and explain everything that we do. We have our own properties, our own houses, brand newly built with everything to the maximum standards of NDIS requirements. And we are building more and more of these houses. So let's support each other, because I've said it before and I'll say it again, every penny that comes from these projects will go to people that are in need, spiritually, mentally, physically, emotionally, you name it. We have also overseas missions. We are actually now supporting more than 160 children in certain countries overseas. Over 600 families every month, food hampers go to their front door. Children receive money for their education, for their well-being, to remain with mom and dad at home, not to be lost and given to government and God knows which shelters they will end up with or in. So these projects like NDIS and other initiatives that we are doing, all the proceeds, I can assure you, and the Lord is the witness, is all the proceeds go to people in need within Australia and outside of Australia. For as long as the Lord permits this piece of wreck to live on earth, I will never, ever, over my dead body, I will never allow anyone to trade in the house of my Father, Jesus Christ. I will bury them if they turn the house into buying and selling, because they will not be in the place where this bishop is. Every penny will go in helping people. This is the Lord, and this is how He built His church on the rock and brought it to this world to be the light of this world, where people come to it as the place of refuge and shelter. The church cannot be rich financially. The church must be rich spiritually. The church cannot be rich with possessions and buildings. The church is known to be rich to Christ when her children are faithful, loving the Lord from the heart, serving Him from the heart. This is the church which Christ purchased and built with His precious blood. This is the church. So if I have in the bank account of the church millions upon millions and hundreds and billions of dollars, none of it will remain there. It will go to the rightful owners, those who are in need, period. For as long as I live, this will always, always be the case. So please help us to help so many people out there. I love you so much. I don't want to let go of you, but I have to, just for a short while. I'll see you next Friday. But let's stand up for the finale prayer, please. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, it is in dying that we're born again to eternal life. Amen. May the Lord Jesus bless you, guard you and protect you all the days of your life, now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace. See you next week. God bless.
knowing you were in control. Resting in your heavenly glory, let your will be done for me. I cast my burdens onto you, Lord, knowing you will take them all. I'm trusting in your blood you shed for me. I know you've covered all my sins. I'm standing burdens onto you, Lord, and knowing you will take them all. I'm trusting in your blood you shed for me. I know you've covered all my sins. I'm standing
I